Today, we are going to explore one of the most fascinating lives in human history, the life of the last pharaoh of ancient Egypt. A woman with a complicated life, filled with betrayals, wars, and love affairs. Join me on this epic journey through the life of one of the most important women in history, a pharaoh who ruled in ancient Egypt during a turbulent era, in a time in which Egypt faced a severe internal crisis, while the mighty Roman Republic was growing threateningly around it. Today, we will delve deep into the life of a monarch who fought against all odds to secure Egypt's independence. So, get ready for something that is not just epic, but awesome. Today, we will unveil the life of Cleopatra. In the time when Cleopatra was born, in the 1st century BC, Egypt was still one of the most important kingdoms of antiquity. As the famous historian Herodotus said, Egypt was a gift of the Nile. The Egyptian economy was entirely conditioned by the Nile River, which annually flooded the surrounding fields, enriching the soil with a fertile layer of silt. The richness of the land, the warm climate, and the abundance of water allowed for abundant crops all along the Nile. Egypt was a true agricultural superpower. There, wheat, barley, dates, and chickpeas were cultivated. All kinds of fish and even water birds were captured. However, Egypt was no longer the great economic and military power it once was. Actually, Egypt had been conquered several centuries earlier by the Persians, and later by the Macedonians under the fabulous Alexander the Great. Alexander was a genius, a shark, a superstar, a force of nature. He conquered the entire Persian Empire, including Egypt. But he died under mysterious circumstances, and his generals divided the empire among themselves. It was Ptolemy who took control of Egypt. Ptolemy was the first pharaoh of the Ptolemaic dynasty, a family with Macedonian origins. This point marked the beginning of a period in which Egypt was ruled by a foreign dynasty, a dynasty with Greek culture and language, very distinct from the Egyptian language and culture of the population. Under the rule of this royal family with Greek culture, Egypt began to experiment transformations. The ancient Egyptian religion, with gods like Ra, Horus, and Osiris, Greek religion began to mix with Egyptian religion. And more importantly, the Ptolemaic dynasty revitalized Egypt by introducing innovations from Greece. They also built a new city that would become the jewel of the ancient world. Alexandria. The city of Alexandria was awesome. It was located at one end of the delta, next to the extensive Nile crops. The city stretched along a coastal strip that divided the Mediterranean Sea from a brackish marsh, known as Lake Mareotis. Its privileged strategic location, controlling the delta's harvests and featuring an important port for exporting cereal, made it the most prosperous and significant city in the kingdom. While historically, Egypt has been a kingdom isolated from its enemies thanks to its natural borders, the city of Alexandria was a harbour opened up to the Mediterranean and became the richest and most vibrant city of its time. The city received cereals from Egypt itself, luxurious woods from Lebanon, exquisite ceramics from Greece, tin from Italy, and wool from the Balkans. But most importantly, the city became the most culturally rich metropolis of antiquity, and most of the culture was thanks to its famous library, the Library of Alexandria. The kings of the Ptolemaic dynasty had the political ambition of acquiring as many books as possible. For 3 centuries, they bought every book they could get their hands on, even paying astronomical sums for them. It's important to point out that books were painstakingly copied by hand on parchment scrolls, requiring countless hours of work for each one. Books were very expensive and rare. They even implemented a policy consisting in that if any ship arrived in Alexandria with a book they didn't have a copy of, the volume would be confiscated to be copied and would be returned to its owners once the copy was completed. Thanks to their eagerness to expand their library, the Library of Alexandria became the largest in antiquity, attracting numerous scholars who came to the city to consult its volumes and archives. With such a vibrant and fascinating city, the Ptolemaic dynasty decided to make it the capital and built a luxurious palace in the city. Nearly 3 centuries after the city's founding, Egypt was ruled by Pharaoh Ptolemy XII. Ptolemy XII married Cleopatra V, and they had 6 children, Berenice IV, Cleopatra VI, Ptolemy XIII, Arsinoe IV, Ptolemy XIV, and our Cleopatra, Cleopatra VII, who was born in 69 BC. The famous Cleopatra was just a princess. You might imagine that, being a princess, she had a wonderful childhood. She would be surrounded by luxury, able to run around the palace, roam the gardens, and even, if she wanted, climb the rooftops. Something like a Disney princess. However, the reality is, Cleopatra's family was a bit problematic. Her father, Ptolemy XII, was known as Ptolemy Aeutis, which means Ptolemy the flutist, because he preferred music and parties over governing. Ptolemy XII became pharaoh after the death of his brother Ptolemy XI, who was assassinated. Similar fates befell Ptolemy X and Ptolemy IX, who were also assassinated. So, we can say that during this time, being part of the Egyptian royal family was a dangerous job. While the royal family was killing each other, Egypt was facing a crucial historical moment. The Roman Republic had evolved from a small state in Italy into a colossal power that sought to control the entire Mediterranean. Egypt had the unfortunate position of being located in the Mediterranean. At this time of history, Egypt lacked the military capacity to survive if the Romans tried to conquer it. Egypt lived alongside a power that could invade it at any moment. Ptolemy XII was aware that he could not confront Rome, so he had to coexist with its powerful neighbour, trying not to provoke the Romans. Any friction could be fatal. Even some voices began to emerge in the Roman Senate, proposing the annexation of Egypt by Rome. Ptolemy implemented a strategy to buy time, because the Romans loved money, a lot of money. He proposed to buy the loyalty of numerous Roman politicians, bribing them with gold. It was his way of defending the independence of Egypt. In this way, he would obtain, through bribery, what he knew he couldn't achieve through war. It seemed like a clever strategy, but the reality was that in the long run, it only brought some time and further weakened Egypt. Giving money to the Romans made Egypt increasingly poor and Rome increasingly rich. and Rome continued to exert pressure. The moment came when Rome demanded the annexation of the island of Cyprus. Ptolemy certainly didn't like the idea, but he knew he couldn't oppose it, so he had to give it to the Romans. When the news reached Egypt, indignation erupted. Now, listen carefully. I told you that the royal family was problematic. Berenice IV, supported by a faction in the palace, discontent with Ptolemy's pro-Roman policy, rebelled against him. In order to avoid being assassinated, the pharaoh had to flee Egypt. And what do you think Ptolemy's wife did? Do you think she grabbed her slipper and went to scold her daughter? Well, no. She allied with her daughter and they began to rule together. But he who laughs last, laughs best. Ptolemy fled to Rome. The time had come to make the enormous amount of gold he had spent bribing Roman politicians count. He met with most of the important politicians in the city, seeking to convince them to invade Egypt and restore him to power. But things didn't go as expected. The Romans didn't want to get involved in a war in Egypt, so they settled for Berenice marrying to ensure the continuation of the dynasty and to prevent new civil wars. Ptolemy XII saw everything as lost. He saw no future, forced to wander the streets of Rome, living in dishonourable exile, or even having to work in the olive fields. But then Berenice, who was a bad girl, decided she didn't like her husband and ordered to have him strangled. Ptolemy took the opportunity to counterattack. He told the Romans how evil his daughter was. Adding a new detail to his request, he promised to give them more money. Yes, more money. Now, they finally accepted. Shocked by the murder and encouraged by the money, the Romans sent an army to Egypt. They defeated Berenice IV's army, restored Ptolemy XII to power, and beheaded Berenice. What? Yes, beheaded her. Whee! Ptolemy resumed his rule for several more years. Young Cleopatra VII grew up and became an adult. Cleopatra was a clever and cultured woman. She was the first Ptolemaic pharaoh able to speak the Egyptian language. All of the other pharaohs of her family only spoke Greek. But she didn't only speak Greek and Egyptian. Apparently, she was also able to speak Ethiopian, Nabataean, Hebrew, Syrian, Persian, Parthian, and Latin. I think it's safe to say that she absolutely rocked. Finally, 4 years later, before his death in 51 BC, Ptolemy XII decreed that two of his other children, young Ptolemy XIII and Cleopatra VII, should rule together. Now, of course, we're talking about the famous Cleopatra. Young Ptolemy XIII was 7 years younger than Cleopatra. According to Egyptian traditions, for them to rule together, they had to marry. But the relationship between the two siblings was far from good. I'm not talking about a lack of passion between them. That, of course, didn't happen to exist. It was because Cleopatra wanted to reign alone. To her, Ptolemy XIII was just an obstacle. Cleopatra and her aides devised a plan. Just like her father, Cleopatra was aware that the superpower of the time, Rome, had the power to decide who would rule Egypt. But they had their own little problems in Rome. Rome was in a civil war. The Senate had prescribed Julius Caesar, the boldest general of the entire Roman Republic. They accused him of starting an illegal war by conquering Gaul without Senate authorization. Actually, the conquest of Gaul wasn't the issue, it was a power struggle. A significant faction of the Roman aristocracy, led by Gnaeus Pompeius Magnus, distrusted him. Well, Gnaeus Pompeius Magnus and other Roman aristocrats didn't trust Julius Caesar and wanted to imprison him. But instead of being intimidated, Caesar was determined to eliminate them and seize power. Rome engulfed in a civil war between Julius Caesar and his supporters against Pompey and his allies. Cleopatra didn't believe that Julius Caesar had a chance of winning, since the majority of Roman territory supported Pompey. Therefore, very intelligently, she understood that she needed to gain the support of the strongest Roman. That's why Cleopatra sent supplies and troops to assist Pompey in the civil war, hoping that if he won the war against Caesar, he might support her against her brother. The situation between Cleopatra and her brother continued to deteriorate. It eventually led to what usually happens when two siblings are angry enough. They declare war with each other. Most of the Egyptians supported Ptolemy XIII, who controlled most of the country. With this situation, Cleopatra had to exile herself to Syria. Everything seemed lost for her. Her brother had taken full control of the country. She had to escape from Egypt and Pompey. Her ally in Rome fled the capital, pursued by Julius Caesar. If things weren't bad enough, Julius Caesar showed his military genius by defeating Pompey at the Battle of Pharsalus in 48 BC. The Pompeian army was destroyed and thousands of soldiers were captured. Pompey survived the battle and escaped again. His destination was Egypt. However, what Pompey didn't know was that Ptolemy not only didn't want to get involved in the war, but also wanted to reconcile with Julius Caesar. When Pompey arrived in Egypt, the welcome he received was not what he expected. The Egyptian soldiers beheaded him. What? Yes, his head. Whee! Caesar, with part of his army, headed towards Egypt intending to capture Pompey. However, when he arrived, Ptolemy XIII sent him Pompey's head. He thought that Caesar would receive the gift with joy, but Julius Caesar felt deeply offended. It was true that Pompey was his enemy. They had fought to the death. But he found it dishonourable that Pompey had been killed and beheaded treacherously. He had committed a huge mistake. Enraged by his actions, Julius Caesar decided to exert pressure on him. Egypt owed Rome 17 million drachmas. Caesar needed the money to pay his army. He also wanted to teach Ptolemy a lesson, so he demanded immediate payment. Initially, Caesar should have been at odds with Cleopatra, because she had aided Pompey. But considering that both Ptolemy XII and Cleopatra had been involved in Pompey's ill-fated demise, both were in a draw. Cleopatra decided to take a gamble and tried to gain Caesar's support. She travelled incognito back to Egypt and managed to be smuggled into the royal palace of Alexandria, hidden inside a rolled-up carpet, thus eluding the Egyptian guards. And here comes a PG-18 moment. Caesar made the royal palace of Alexandria his headquarters. The servant brought the carpet before Caesar, and as it was unrolled, Cleopatra emerged with all her sensuality and said, Hello, Caesar. Grr. We can say that Cleopatra knew how to be extremely convincing. Between the two of them, the flames of love ignited. Caesar decided to mediate between Cleopatra and Ptolemy XIII, forcing him to accept joint rule with Cleopatra. Ptolemy reluctantly agreed, as the 4,000 Roman soldiers in Alexandria prevented him from refusing. It seemed that Cleopatra had regained her position and could gradually gain more power at the expense of her brother. But now, let's return to the family messes. Do you remember another sister in the family named Arsinoe IV? Well, she escaped from the royal palace and proclaimed herself pharaoh, denouncing Cleopatra for selling out to the Romans. The true Egyptians, those who wanted to see Julius Caesar out of Egypt and considered it unworthy for a pharaoh to be involved with a Roman, were urged to join her. Finally, a revolt against Cleopatra and Caesar erupted. Thousands of Egyptian soldiers and citizens took up arms against Julius Caesar, Cleopatra, and the Roman soldiers. The Roman army barricaded themselves inside the royal palace of Alexandria, where the rebels besieged them. Caesar sent a messenger in search of reinforcements. The Romans were outnumbered, but they made their training count, managing to withstand their much larger enemy. During the battles between the Romans and the Egyptians, a disastrous event occurred. The renowned library of Alexandria, where thousands of books were housed, many of them unique, caught fire. The fire was one of the most catastrophic events in ancient history. A significant portion of accumulated knowledge from centuries was lost there. Finally, Julius Caesar's reinforcements arrived, and they managed to defeat the troops of Arsinoe IV. Cleopatra and Caesar seized control of the entire city, and the surviving troops of Arsinoe joined forces with Ptolemy XIII, ready to stand united. Now that he had received reinforcements, Caesar ordered an advance against the Egyptian army, which he defeated in the Battle of the Nile. The victory was complete. Arsinoe was captured by the Romans, and Ptolemy XIII attempted to escape by boat. However, the overloaded vessel, carrying survivors, capsized and sank. Ptolemy XIII perished in the waters of the Nile River. With one brother dead and the other sister captured, only one brother remained free, young Ptolemy XIV, who was 20 years younger than her. Still a child. He was the only one who could, in theory, challenge Cleopatra for her throne. Once again, following tradition, Cleopatra and young Ptolemy married to rule together. But the marriage did not prevent Caesar and Cleopatra from embarking on one of the most famous cruises in history. For 3 months, they travelled through Egypt via the Nile, discovering its awesome wonders. They visited fertile farmlands, beheld the pyramids, which were already 2,500 years old at the time. They explored villages, crops, temples, oases, and the desert sands. During the 3 month cruise, their love never waned. And it came as no surprise when Cleopatra's belly grew, as she gave birth to a child whom she named Ptolemy XV, Philopator Philometor Caesar, known to the world as Caesarion. Cleopatra had already established herself in power and become the true ruler of Egypt. However, Julius Caesar did not stay in Egypt any longer. He had to finish fighting against the remaining followers of Pompey, so he left Egypt. After Caesar's victory, Cleopatra travelled to Rome to visit him. It was a challenging journey. In Rome, Egyptian culture caused fascination, but at the same time, it generated some rejection. Many saw Cleopatra as a foreign queen with excessive influence over Julius Caesar. Some even feared that traditional Roman values would be contaminated by Egyptian culture. While Cleopatra was in Rome, a drama unfolded. Julius Caesar was assassinated. A group of senators who distrusted his intentions and believed he wanted to be crowned king stabbed him to death. Initially, Cleopatra feared for her life, but Caesar's supporters quickly took control of the city and restored peace. Cleopatra harbored hope that Caesar had named Caesarion as her heir. This decision would grant her a vast fortune and even the possibility of jointly ruling Egypt and Rome. The reality was that despite being her only son, Caesar did not name Caesarion as his heir. Instead, he chose his great nephew Octavian. The reason is clear. In a society as classist, traditional, and patrilineal as Rome, Caesarion could never have been a legitimate heir. Caesar and Cleopatra were not married, so Caesarion was considered an illegitimate child. Even if he had been chosen, he lacked the sufficient status to be respected by the influential Roman families. Caesarion was of mixed heritage, with a Roman father and an Egyptian mother. There was no place for him in Rome at that time. The most positive outcome for Cleopatra from Caesar's will was the return of Cyprus, which was bequeathed back to Egypt. Disillusioned, Cleopatra returned to Egypt. She had lost her major support in Rome, and her kingdom was once again in danger. Meanwhile, Rome plunged into a new civil war. Octavian and Mark Antony, one of Caesar's generals, joined forces to fight against the assassins. For several years, things returned to tranquility in Egypt, except for one thing. Her brother and husband, Ptolemy XIV, died. We don't know if he died of the flu, appendicitis, or in mysterious circumstances. But what is clear is that it worked out well for Cleopatra, as she placed her own 2-year-old son on the throne, while she still remained the one in control. Cleopatra had a lot to manage. Many irrigation channels were filled with mud. There was a year when the River Nile did not rise enough, which resulted in a lower than expected harvest. With a malnourished population, diseases multiplied and outbreaks of the plague occurred in various cities. From the government, Cleopatra had to manage healthcare and canal cleaning, while also having to increase taxes to compensate for the reduction in income. It was a challenging time, as rising taxes, especially during a period of scarcity, led to increased unpopularity. From this period, some reliefs have been preserved. Cleopatra appears alongside her son, such as in the Temple of Hathor in Dendera. Here we can see her in a large depiction with little Caesarion by her side. The Fayum Stele, dedicated to the crocodile god, also depicts Cleopatra, this time with young Caesarion in her arms. Here we can see the queen's name in the Greek alphabet. But, as always, in this complicated family, a storm was approaching. Arsinoe, who had been captured by Julius Caesar, was released. I don't fully understand this move. Julius Caesar had defended Cleopatra at all costs. and Arsinoe posed a real threat to her. Nevertheless, Arsinoe had been sent to the island of Cyprus, where she ruled in Cleopatra's name. Now that Caesar was dead and Rome had plunged into another civil war, no one would pay attention if Cleopatra ordered Arsinoe's death. She sent a fleet to Cyprus with a clear order to kill Arsinoe. However, her sister escaped to the provinces controlled by Caesar's assassins. If they were to win the war, she could try to have them put her on the throne of Egypt. Arsinoe had escaped. But in Rome, more things were happening. Caesar's assassins, led by Cassius and Brutus, controlled the east, the richest part of the Roman Republic. However, some giants, sharks, superstars, mega bros, joined forces against them. They were Octavian, Caesar's nephew and grandson, Mark Antony, Caesar's general and friend, and Lepidus, a not so prominent figure. Together, they formed the Second Triumvirate, named after the earlier triumvirate formed by Caesar, Pompey, and Crassus. The three of them divided power and fought together against Caesar's assassins, defeating them in the Battle of Philippi. The defeat of the assassins was total. After their victory, the three triumvirs proceeded to divide control over the Roman provinces. Mark Antony, who had distinguished himself militarily over his two companions, was able to choose the richest provinces, those in the east. While Lepidus was inconsequential, tensions between Mark Antony and Octavian were increasingly growing. Deep down, both of them desired to seize total power, just like Caesar. Rome was too small for the ambitions of the two. Mark Antony was quite a peculiar character. If Julius Caesar was a tough guy, he was a super tough guy. He was a drunkard, womanizer, and partygoer. He was married to a woman named Fulvia and basically had three hobbies: war, drinking, and, well, you know. Cleopatra received a message from Mark Antony demanding her presence. The Roman general planned to conquer Parthia, an enemy kingdom of Rome. He wanted Egyptian money and troops. Cleopatra decided to support him. The meeting took place in the city of Tarsus. Cleopatra travelled there in a very luxurious ship. And now comes another PG-18 moment. Just like years before with Julius Caesar, Cleopatra knew how to be extremely convincing. Cleopatra overwhelmed Mark Antony with a luxury that the Romans had never seen before. Do you remember that cruise through the Nile that we called the Love Boat? Now, Cleopatra downloads the DLC and launched the Love Boat 2.0. She travelled to Tarsus in an awesome ship adorned with luxurious carpets, exquisite tableware, and expensive tables and seats. She hosted several banquets for Mark Antony and his generals. They enjoyed exquisite delicacies while musicians played the finest melodies. Furthermore, she presented herself before him dressed as Aphrodite, the goddess of love. If Aphrodite was known for anything, it was for being practically naked. When Mark Antony boarded her ship, he was amazed. Cleopatra was surrounded by a retinue dressed as cupids and nymphs. Later on, she appeared practically naked, adorned with the most exquisite jewels. Well, it's not a surprise that after being so convincing, three children were born from this relationship. Mark Antony was so in love with Cleopatra that he left for Egypt with her. The trick of the Love Boat 2.0 had worked. Meanwhile, his wife Fulvia was in Rome, managing the city on his behalf. Time passed. Mark Antony continued to stay in Egypt, supposedly working. Even the deaf had heard of the news of what was happening in Egypt. Mark Antony had been living with Cleopatra for almost 2 years. When his wife wrote a letter demanding an explanation for what he was doing in Egypt, he responded with his famous phrase, XD. So, Fulvia very cleverly devised a plan to force Mark Antony to leave Egypt. She started to enworst relations with Octavian. Since she managed Mark Antony's affairs on his behalf, worsening her relationship with him meant harming him. If Mark Antony didn't want to lose his power, he would have to return to Rome, leaving Cleopatra never to see her again. Mark Antony left Egypt, but shortly after, Fulvia died. The relationship between Octavian and Mark Antony had deteriorated to the point of almost going to war. Before declaring war with each other, they attempted to resolve their differences. Mark Antony married Octavia, Octavian's sister. Perhaps by uniting their families, they could solve their problems. Spoiler, it didn't work. For 3 years, Mark Antony and Octavia lived in Athens, 39 to 36 BCE. But as Octavian had achieved a significant military victory, Mark Antony needed to achieve another victory, or people would start to prefer Octavian over him. Mark Antony resumed the idea of attacking the Parthian Empire, but beware of the Parthians. The Parthians were a formidable empire. They had a massive force of horse archers that were practically untouchable. They were faster than the Roman legions and could escape while showering them with a rain of arrows. The legendary general Crassus had died when he attempted to conquer the Parthian Empire. We can say that he made a crass mistake. Mark Antony returned to Egypt, where Cleopatra would lend him money to pay the salaries of the thousands of soldiers he needed for his conquests. It was not only a business trip. While Octavia stayed in Athens, you can imagine what was happening in Egypt. Perhaps you're wondering what Cleopatra gained by joining Mark Antony. Well, first of all, it seems that there was genuine love between them. From this moment on, Mark Antony and Cleopatra became inseparable and spent the rest of their lives together. Obviously, Octavia was left in Athens, saying, "What the fuck?" Secondly, Rome was growing at a spectacular speed. The conquests of the past decades were enormous, and governors were needed to control them. Appointing Roman governors hadn't worked out well. They often didn't obey, and if they became too powerful, they would start to seek more power. Just remember what happened with Julius Caesar. A much better plan was to create small client kingdoms in the newly conquered areas. These small kingdoms would be loyal to Rome, and their foreign monarchs could never aspire to control Rome itself. Cleopatra's Egypt was one of these states. Cleopatra just aspired to acquire new territories through her relationship with Mark Antony. In fact, Mark Antony made the kings of Judea and Nabatea to cede Phoenicia and Cilicia and part of Nabatea to her. Cleopatra's plan was working brilliantly. Finally, Mark Antony set out with his army, ready to give the Parthians a beating. But it was him who suffered the defeat. The Parthians proved invincible once again. Mark Antony returned to the Mediterranean coast defeated, and another drama started. Octavian and Mark Antony. Rome was too small for the both of them. The war between them was only a matter of time. If Mark Antony wanted to triumph, he needed money and soldiers. He faced a great dilemma. Egypt was very wealthy. If he stayed with Cleopatra, he would have enough money to rebuild his army. However, his enmity with Octavian would escalate, because each day spent in Egypt further humiliated Octavia. On the other hand, if he returned to Octavia, the enmity would slow down, but he would lose the economic support of Cleopatra and wouldn't have enough money to match Octavian's army. In the long run, he would be defeated by Octavian. Based on his personal interests, Mark Antony made the most intelligent decision. He returned to Cleopatra. Just 1 year later, Mark Antony marched once again to war against the Parthians. And although he didn't manage to defeat them entirely, he at least conquered Armenia. Upon his return, they celebrated a grand parade. Mark Antony made one of the most fateful decisions of his life, a step that sealed the fate of the two lovers. Until then, he had been a Roman general. Everything he had conquered belonged, as it should be, to Rome. But then he made the so-called donations of Alexandria. He requested a divorce from Octavia, effectively ending his alliance with Octavian. More importantly, he donated Roman territories to his children with Cleopatra. Armenia to Alexander Helios, Cyrenaica and Libya to Cleopatra Selene, and Syria and Cilicia to Ptolemy Philadelphus. In this way, Mark Antony made it clear that he renounced his Roman identity and prioritized the interests of Egypt. However, this action also incurred a grave illegality, because those territories were not his to give, they belonged to Rome. Now, Octavian had the perfect excuse to destroy him. He accused Mark Antony of treason. He was giving Roman territories to Egypt and prioritizing his half-Egyptian children over his true homeland. Thanks to Mark Antony's distancing from Rome, Octavian had become the true owner of the Republic. And now, he would not allow Mark Antony and Cleopatra to continue ruling Egypt. Years of tension would soon come to an end. War was now inevitable. Although it may seem unbelievable, neither Octavian nor the Romans in general were affected by the fact that Mark Antony had been cheating on his wife with Cleopatra for years. In a deeply patriarchal society, like Rome, such matters were considered private affairs, dirty laundry to be dealt with at home. They did not find Octavia's humiliation offensive. After all, it had not been a marriage based on love. According to Roman law, men were allowed to cheat on their wives, while women who did so were committing a crime. So, the problem between Octavian and Mark Antony was not a family offence, it was a power struggle. Octavian prepared to attack Egypt. Mark Antony and Cleopatra prepared to counterattack. There was a chance that Egypt could rival Rome. The Egyptian economy was mobilized for war. Taxes from Egypt and those from Marco Antonio's Roman provinces were used to recruit a massive army. The monarchs of the client kingdoms were also compelled to contribute troops. Finally, a massive army led by the two lovers headed for Greece. From there, they would invade Italy and force Octavian to sign a humiliating peace treaty. But before they could attack the south of Italy, Octavian landed his army in Greece. The fleet of Mark Antony and Cleopatra anchored in the Gulf of Ambracia. Octavian's fleet sailed to Greece and anchored around the Gulf of Ambracia. The lovers became trapped with no escape routes. Octavian's fleet was far superior. A confrontation would result in certain defeat. They couldn't defeat Octavian's army on land either, as it had fortified itself on well-protected hills. All attacks were ruinous. Food was also starting to run out for the army. Octavian's plan was clear. Without naval supplies, the army of his two enemies would starve to death. He would let the enemy army perish or surrender. Both Mark Antony and Cleopatra faced a difficult dilemma. If they withdrew their army from there, they would lose the fleet. But if they tried to get their ships out through the narrow mouth of the Gulf, they would be massacred. But they had no other option. They had to withdraw their soldiers and try to get the ships out by any means necessary, and at least attempt to save some of them. Finally, Mark Antony led a portion of the fleet, with Cleopatra in the second line. They had around 240 ships, compared to Octavian's 400. They were greatly outnumbered, but their ships were larger, more resilient, and equipped with catapults. Their plan was to engage Octavian's fleet in close combat, where they had an advantage. If, on the other hand, Octavian acted like the Parthian horsemen, using their high mobility to attack from a distance, Mark Antony and Cleopatra's slow and heavy ships would suffer irreparable damage. Finally, Mark Antony launched his fleet forward. A fierce naval battle began. Octavian's ships withdrew, opening up the defence formation. The movement gave them more space to manoeuvre around without Mark Antony's ships being able to catch them. Meanwhile, more and more of Antony's ships began to fall prey to the flames and sank. And then, a drama unfolded. Cleopatra ordered her ships to advance, but not to support Mark Antony's fleet. Instead, it was to escape. The Queen and her 60 ships abandoned the battle and set sail for Egypt. Seeing Cleopatra leaving, Mark Antony jumped into the water and swam to another faster ship. From there, he gave the order to follow his love. With his two enemies fleeing and a clear numerical superiority, Octavian finished off the enemy ships. He had achieved a total victory. Cleopatra's escape has been heavily criticised, accusing her of cowardice or betrayal. However, it is necessary to understand the context. The battle was already lost. Both Cleopatra and Mark Antony were well aware of that. Furthermore, Mark Antony returned to her, and their relationship remained as strong as ever, which suggests that it was likely part of the plan to escape by any means necessary. They both managed to save their lives and salvage part of the fleet. The escape plan had worked, but the problem was that the strategy errors that had led them to the hopeless situation could not be rectified. The worst blow came when the land army, fleeing from Greece, surrendered when it realized there was no escape. Now, both of them were left without a fleet and an army. They were at the mercy of Octavian, who, leading an intact army, was prepared to invade Egypt. However, a whole year passed before Octavian took the decisive step. Knowing that victory was impossible, Mark Antony renounced his claims to Rome and asked Octavian to let him live in Egypt as a common citizen. By accepting that, he would become an ordinary citizen without any pretensions, so war could be avoided. But Octavian did not accept. Then it was Cleopatra who made a move. She wrote to Octavian, pleading to let her children rule in Egypt, but Octavian did not accept that either. Finally, Rome attacked Egypt. Mark Antony tried to stop Octavian in battle, seeing himself defeated and knowing that he would not receive mercy, he committed suicide by impaling himself with a sword. That blow was very tough for Cleopatra, but it would not be the last. Octavian took Alexandria effortlessly. The capital fell, and Cleopatra had become his prisoner. But she still had one last card to play over the victor, although there are different versions of how it happened. One source tells us that Cleopatra presented herself again to Octavian in a seductive manner, trying to be, again, extremely convincing. But the truth is, given the context, it is unlikely that she believed it would work. Caesar and Mark Antony had never been her enemies, but Octavian was. Thinking that she could seduce someone who despised her so deeply doesn't seem very realistic. The other source tells us that she presented herself to him crying, dishevelled, with scratches all over her body, portraying herself as a woman broken and desperate, seeking the mercy of the victor. This version, in my opinion, is much more believable. But she failed to obtain anything from Octavian. He was determined to take control of Egypt. Seeing that all was lost, Cleopatra asked for permission to visit the tomb of Mark Antony. There, next to the body of her life's love, she allowed herself to be bitten by a poisonous snake. That's how Cleopatra, defeated, died beside Mark Antony's tomb. But what happened to her children? Caesarion, the son of Caesar and Cleopatra, vanished from history. He was likely killed by Octavian because he could have been recognized as the true successor of Caesar. After all, Octavian was nothing more than his grandnephew. Who would have more legitimacy? An illegitimate son, but a son nonetheless, or a grandnephew? This dilemma gave Octavian headaches, and certainly, if Caesarion disappeared, he would be the only existing successor. Octavian even changed his name, and from then on was known as Caesar Augustus. Calling himself Caesar, thus equalizing himself as much as possible to his great uncle. However, the children of Mark Antony and Cleopatra had a better future. After all, they couldn't claim anything in Rome, since Mark Antony had been just another general. Cleopatra Selene was married to the king of Mauritania. As for Alexander Helios and Ptolemy Philadelphus, their fate is unknown, but it is possible that they survived and faded into obscurity. With Cleopatra's death, Egypt ceased to be independent. The millennia-old country had lost the war against that small city on the banks of the Tiber River. Octavian, now known as Caesar Augustus, turned Egypt into a Roman province. Gradually, the ancient Egyptian culture began to fade away in the Roman culture. But what is our opinion of Cleopatra? Was she a deceiver who sought power at any cost? Or was she a queen who tried to secure the independence of our kingdom? Certainly, she is not a person we can judge with our moral values. Not only because she lived 2,000 years ago, with moral codes very different from our own, but also because we have to understand her context. On one hand, the Ptolemaic dynasty was a family, as we have seen, where betrayals were very common. Her father, her uncle, and many before them had died in palace intrigues. If Cleopatra had been meek, She would have been killed by any of her siblings. It was a family in which you either killed your siblings or they killed you. On the other hand, the other powerful figures around Cleopatra were not very different from her either. Julius Caesar, Mark Antony, or Augustus were tremendously ambitious individuals. They did not hesitate to cause wars and led thousands of people to death in order to obtain power. Cleopatra did nothing more than any other queen of her time. It was an era in which the big fish ate the small one. Survival meant trying to be the big fish. Finally, did Cleopatra seek to take advantage of Caesar and Mark Antony? The reality is that she did, but they also took advantage of her. She obtained protection from the two great generals, but they also obtained Egyptian wheat, money, and soldiers. After all, Cleopatra sought nothing but to guarantee the independence of her kingdom, a kingdom that seemed destined to succumb to Rome. She tried to play her cards right by aligning herself with those from whom she could get guarantees to strengthen Egypt. With Mark Antony, she almost succeeded. If Mark Antony has not made the tremendous strategic mistake of getting trapped in Greece, perhaps they would have achieved victory. A victory that could have turned the land of the Nile into a superpower capable of reversing history. But history cannot be changed. Cleopatra will always be remembered for having an awesome and fascinating life, full of adventures, betrayals, and love affairs. Her life became legendary. All of her conflicts and her tragic ending will continue to fuel the legend. If you've made it this far, please click like and subscribe. You might be interested in watching one of the next videos where we talk about super interesting topics. If you love geography and history, I recommend you watch more videos and share them with anyone you think might be interested. Thank you so much for watching and look forward to seeing you again soon.